Hello, welcome to another titillating episode of Corner Conversations. My name is Roger Urban. My co-host is the one and only Paul W. Marino.
Thank goodness.
Hello,
Paul. I mean, thank goodness I'm the only one.
Yeah, true. So I'll lead off today. I brought in a booklet, large size booklet that I bought the other day.
A little higher.
There you go. It's called Brick by Brick, History of New England Milltown for Students. I don't know why it's for students, because I enjoyed it. Actually, it discusses the history of North Adams. And I went through it and I picked out some what I thought were interesting points. Page 5 discusses the weather, which has plagued at times in North Adams. It says, North Adams was often flooded, and I can attest to that. Early records in the 1800s show the entire Main Street area underwater, with homes and businesses washed away. There were major floods in 1869, 1927, 1936, 1938, and in 1948. I believe that was the last major flood.
Mm-hmm.
At that time, the mayor, Mayor James Bowes, I think that's how you pronounce his name, pushed for earlier plans for flood control to move forward. And in the 50s, the flood control project started. And I remember when that was going in, even though I didn't live here in North Adams at the time.
Well, it was going in Adams as well.
Yes. I don't remember it in Adams so much. I remember the section down behind Park Street that goes around. Then it goes to the blizzard of 1888. Now, do you remember that one, Paul?
Well, I wasn't around during it, but I do mention it on the Main Street Walk, and I think the Center Street Walk, too, because I have a photograph taken in the winter of 1888.
Wow.
The sidewalks are shoveled and the snow in the street is a good 7 feet high.
It says the snow began falling on Sunday, March 11th, and didn't stop until 4 days later, and a total of 37 inches fell. However, the strong winds blew at between 30 and 40 miles an hour, which must have had a terrific impact on making drifts. So that was a biggie.
Yeah, and out west it was called the White Death. A cowboy would freeze to death on his horse, and neither other would fall over until spring came and the thaw.
Out west of Massachusetts?
Yes.
Okay. The next section is Fort Massachusetts. I won't go into that because I think we belabored that quite enough. It says that there is a replica of the interior of the fort at the North Adams Museum of History and Science. I've yet to see that, but I will try to make a point of getting in there this year. Then it talked about the Battle of Fort Massachusetts. We discussed that at length in a previous show. But I found this next section interesting. It's early settlers. In May of 1739, three townships were surveying. Clarksburg, East Hoosick, which is now Adams, and North Adams. And West Hoosick, which is now Williamstown. In 1741, and this is interesting, the northern boundary of Massachusetts was surveyed. There was a small mistake made during the survey, and Williamstown and North Adams were really supposed to be part of Vermont. Thank goodness. The Vermonters probably don't want us.
Probably not, yeah.
There were no settlers here at that time, so the land in East Hoosick was surveyed later in 1749, mapping out the area 7 miles north and south and 5 miles east and west of
yeah,
the town.
And that was an error too, because they were ordered to make the townships square.
Uh-huh.
And East Hoosick was made a rectangle.
It was?
Yes.
Huh.
Well, as you said, 7 by 5.
Yeah. Interesting. We're talking about the name of the town of Adams. And maybe we could have a quiz as to who it was named after, because there were several Adamses.
I know.
Who was it, Paul?
Samuel Adams.
Sam Adams. And it's interesting they picked Sam. Now, Sam was a pretty vociferous character. A little bit headstrong, a little bit nasty,
mm-hmm.
but he signed the Declaration of Independence and later became governor of the state. So there
and,
we go.
And if you have a beer named after you, you can't be
you
all
can't
bad.
Be bad. Yeah. Whoops. Then they talked a little bit. This talks a little bit about early settlers, including Ephraim Williams, who had a grist mill, which turned grain into flour. And that was built along the Hoosick Subway, Hoosick River, where the Subway restaurant.
Actually, it was built a little further south.
Okay.
It was part of his contract. He was to build and maintain Fort Massachusetts,
right.
But he was also supposed to build a dam and put a grist mill at one end and a sawmill at the other.
It goes into a little bit of it. In February of 1794, Jeremiah Colgrove, name we're familiar with,
mm-hmm.
Senior, Elijah Brown, and Giles Barnes purchased property included in an old sawmill and grist mill and about 80 acres of land. Wheat was a new crop being grown. Now that's interesting. Wheat.
Mm-hmm.
We wouldn't think of wheat being grown this far north, but it is. The new dam provided water and power to the mill, and one farmer did pretty well. It doesn't mention his name, but it was a farmer on Notch Road, and he grew 700 bushels of wheat in 1 year. It's pretty good. Jeremiah Colgrove, let's go back to him for a second. He was a pretty ambitious man. In 1800, he built a new kind of mill. This was a oil mill, and he used flax seeds.
Mm-hmm.
And if you grind up flax, it does create an oil. Okay? And that was made into oil cakes, which was food for sheep and cattle, and to run the machinery in the mills.
Mm-hmm.
Flax is a plant that was used in those days to make linen. Linen cloth is made primarily of flax. Let's see, then it goes into Mr. Jeremiah Wilbur. Are you familiar with him?
Yes, the name does ring a bell.
Okay. He was born in Rhode Island, and he bought land in 1767 when he was 14 years old. He would eventually own a total of 1,600 acres, and his land began at the top of the Notch and then went over to the top of Mount Williams. Pretty hilly area that he bought.
Yes.
His house was located where Notch Road and Reservoir Road meets, and there's an old cemetery in this spot. I'd like to go up to there someday and see what's there, if anything.
Oh, yeah, it's definitely there. What you do is you go up as if you're going to Mount Greylock, and there's a parking area, and you go straight in the Bellows Pipe Trail until it crosses the first stream. And whether the stream is running or if it's dry, you'll know it's there. And you turn right and go up the hill, and eventually you will come to a walled-in cemetery. Mm-hmm. Some of the stones have fallen, but there are headstones and footstones, and wow, that's where the Wilbers are.
And I imagine they go back quite a ways, the 1700s.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
Another interesting footnote is that Henry David Thoreau visited this area.
Thoreau.
Thoreau.
No, the correct pronunciation is Thoreau.
You say Thoreau?
No, I've looked it up.
Okay.
That's actually...
We will go by Paul's definition of this
darn
author.
Darn tootin'.
His claim to fame for the area is he made a climb up the Bellows Pipe Trail to the summit of Mount Greylock and spent the night there outdoors. I imagine he did because there was nothing up there.
Yeah. Well, he didn't actually go up the Bellows Pipe. The thing is, when you get to that cemetery, go past a little ways and you'll find a road running along the side of the mountain. That is the road that he went up.
I see.
And
did he come down that way?
Good question. He doesn't say.
Right.
His description of his visit to North Adams, it's insulting in some ways because he came through Florida, but he doesn't mention that town at all. He came down into North Adams. He bought a tin cup and some rice and went up to the summit of Greylock, which at that time was known by another name, which escapes me right now, but he went up there. The thing is, this is all an aside in his book about a trip that he made with his brother on the Merrimack River.
Mm-hmm.
So he got up one morning and there's thick fog. Well, you can talk about thick fog. And suddenly he's in Florida looking down the mountain at North Adams, goes down to North Adams, buys his tin cup, buys his rice, goes up to Greylock. There's a tower that was built by some Williams students, and he spent the night there using some leftover boards for blankets. And when he woke up in the morning, the entire valley was filled with fog, so his shadow literally stretched across the valley.
There we go.
And then, boom, he's back at the Merrimack River with his brother.
We will leave him for now.
Good idea.
Yeah. Going back to North Adams, in 1794, the total number of houses in this area was 11. Keep that figure in mind. By 1825, the village was small, village of North Adams, but starting to grow. Two factories were built that year, along with two grist mills, a sawmill, an oil mill, a machine shop, and a tannery. There were now two churches, two hotels to accommodate the six mm-hmm. people that come in, two blacksmith shops, five stores, three shoemakers, one hat maker, a milliner, one harness maker, and one tailor shop. The entire village included only Main Street, Eagle Street, and Center Street. There were
and
only about...
And what were the two hotels?
I don't remember. You told me, but I don't remember.
Yes, one was the Richmond House.
Right.
That would become the Richmond Hotel, and the other was the Old Black Tavern.
Okay. At that time, in 1825, there were about 50 houses. So it grew from 11 to 50 in mm-hmm. a period of time, about 40 years. The population is interesting. In 1830, were 1,100 people. 1860, it grew to 4,000. 1875, there was a boom, and it went up to 15,700. 1890, 16,000, and by 1896, 25,000. So much for that. Now, this is an interesting little side story. That in the earliest days of the town, or whatever you want to call it, the village, people walked to Williamstown to get their groceries. Apparently there was not a grocery store here.
Mm-hmm.
The first grocery store was opened by a Mr. Ferrand, I don't know if I'm pronouncing his name or it's Ferrand, doesn't give a date. Doesn't give a date. But there was a gentleman named Christopher Penniman who was an apprentice who came to the village with Mr. Veazey. Familiar name, huh? Especially for
yes.
Sometime before 1789, Sutton and Wells opened a shop for merchandise in 1795 on Main Street, which is the site of the Holiday Inn today. In 1803, Dr. James Cummings built a house and store on Main Street. In 1825, there were five stores. They're owned by Dr. James Cummings, W. E. Brayton, Edward Richmond, Ezra Whitaker, and Michael Cheesebrough. Very interesting. Settlers in the 1800s were making cloth by hand. Cloth was woven on home hand looms. It was a very rough, rustic type of cloth,
yes,
I would imagine.
And it was cottage industries.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that Jeremiah Colgrove did was he added a fulling process to his grist mill. And fulling is essentially cleaning the wool.
Mm-hmm.
So the cottage industries, what they did was you took your wool, brought it to one place to be washed, another place to be spun into thread, to be carded, that is to be separated into the fibers, another place to be spun into thread, another place to be woven into cloth, another place to be dyed or printed, and so on.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
This goes on
See, I am so good for something.
This goes on to talk about the Hoosick Tunnel, and I'm going to kind of skip over that because I have another book for a later show. Just to mention a few highlights. The work started in the tunnel in 1851, but the first train didn't go through until 1875. It cost $21,241,842 to build.
And mind, that's an approximation.
Yeah, and that was way back when a dollar was worth a hell of a lot more than it is today. 196 lives were lost. I don't know the accuracy of that number, but as I mentioned in an earlier show, someone asked me if there was a mass grave at Hillside for 90 workers at the Hoosick Tunnel, and there are no records of that, none whatsoever.
No, I shouldn't think, they were keeping records by that time, so I would not expect that.
No, I wouldn't either. Okay, in 1911, the tunnel was electrified, which is very interesting. And in 1958, the last passenger train went through the tunnel. Sad day. This section of the B&M Railroad became all freight and is used.
The what railroad?
B&M.
Oh, because it sounded like you said D and
no,
M.
B.
Okay.
B as in bumblebee.
Gotcha.
You're going to be a pain in my tush today, aren't you? Okay.
Well, you know, I'm reminded of when we did the documentary Forgotten Glory, and I had someone from the transcript over to my house to do a preview, and for some reason he brought a friend with him, and it gets to the point where it was common for people who had the money to keep their horses, carriages, and sleighs conveniently close to home. And the reporter said, "Sleighs?" And his friend said, "Oh, yeah." Well, then I found out why he was so excited about that. In the story in the paper, it was common to have slave quarters in the barn. Slaves in New England years after the Civil War.
Yeah,
right.
It really doesn't work that way.
No.
Okay. Let's see. It says North Adams was became a booming town in 1896. And this was the year that North Adams officially went from a town to being a city.
Well, she missed something then.
Go ahead.
Because we were booming right after the tunnel was complete. It put North Adams at a crossroads. And in 1878, we seceded from the mother town and became the town of North Adams. That is, all the villages in the north half of the town became the town of North Adams. And the growth continued to boom, and in 1896, we became the city.
Right.
Pardon.
And the first mayor was Albert C. Houghton. I always wondered who Houghton School was named after, because I went there. Good for me.
Yeah.
He was elected the first city's mayor, and at that time, the city's largest population was about 25,000 people. Pretty good size. Now, why didn't they have a mayor before? Well, they didn't have enough people. So they had town meetings.
Yes.
But when you have 25,000 people, you can't have town meetings. It doesn't work that way. So another interesting sidelight of this was when he was elected, they also elected councilmen, 21 of them. Can you imagine?
Oh boy.
The council meetings at that point with 21 councilors. Oh, we have enough problems with 10. There were two daily newspapers and three weekly newspapers. The dailies was a transcript published every afternoon except Sunday and the Evening Herald. Then there was the weekly transcript, the Sunday Democrat, and the weekly news. Then it goes on to talk about James Hunter, who I think we belabored that at on a mm-hmm. previous show. So I won't go into it now. But one of the major industries in North Adams, and I wasn't aware of this, was making bricks.
Oh, yeah. They were making bricks for the tunnel.
Yeah, and even before. Bricks were manufactured here as early as 1786. Baker Jones, in 1800, had a brickyard near where the Freeman Print Works was, near the corner of Eagle and Canal Street. I think that's fascinating. North Adams Brick Company, NABCO, built a house so that workers would have a place to live, all in one house. So I don't know how many workers they had. The house still stands and is located at 219 Notch Road. I don't know if it still stands today.
Have to check that out. And I need to point out, we're about halfway through the show.
Okay. I'll be quick. I won't go through this whole thing then. The 1900 census shows that many young Polish men were living and working at the brickyard. So they were some of the first immigrants, I would believe, at that time. Not the very first, but in the group.
Well, no, that 1900? Immigrants were coming in a lot earlier.
Yeah, but many, it says. So I don't know how many is many. Anyhow, the other interesting thing is they employed children. Now, what did the children do? Well, they went out in the sunshine, and they turned their molded brick side to side every so often so that they would dry evenly. They were paid a penny for each brick they turned. Turning them, it helped to dry every side of the brick, obviously. But a penny for 100 bricks. Interesting. All right, we'll leave that. That goes one more to brick making, cutting store, which we had discussed on a previous show. The Arnold Print Works, I believe we discussed, but it said that they, one of the things that played a big role in the Arnold Print Works is the Civil War. They had invented a successful process calling the Blue Dip, which was used to make uniforms.
I don't think so, because they wore woolen uniforms.
doesn't say, it just says,
Certainly Blackington benefited from the Civil War.
Absolutely.
But most of the Yarnold print works wasn't built until after the war.
This next session goes into Blackington. As we're running short on time, Paul, I would defer to you and we'll save this for the next show.
Thank you. Okay, what I have is a new story. I've been working on it for a few weeks. This is titled Marriage. And I just got it posted within the past few days. This is science fiction.
No.
It's about a, well, there's a race called the Zinc, Z-I-N-Q. They are half insect. And what the other half is, they're the only ones who know. The Zinc Empire covers 1,000 worlds. And the Zinc Empress lays eggs for 50 years at a stretch, and then she has to mate with a male from a different species who is chosen for the particular qualities of his DNA, and then he is apprehended and delivered to her for courtship. So it's about a man named Exe, who is the one chosen to be her new mate. So what I'm going to read for now anyway is this is a quote-unquote letter that he's composing to his father. He's actually recording it on a little thing like a
tape recorder.
No, not a tape recorder,
iPhone.
But an iPad, something like that.
Did they have those in those days?
This is future, or maybe, who knows? Exe stared at the recorder with trepidation, having no idea what to say. That, and his brain swam with fatigue. It had been a long day and he was in dire need of sleep, but this felt more important to him. At length he yawned and tapped the record icon. Hi, Fath. As you've no doubt heard, I am now in the keeping of the Zinc. And, as you've probably guessed, I am the Zinc Empress's new mate. I know you're worried, but I hope you'll believe me when I say you don't have to. Considering all things, I'm very comfortable and they're taking excellent care of me. And I'm getting to know the Empress. I know it sounds crazy, but she's actually very interesting and, nicer than you'd expect. Okay, I know what you're thinking. How can my son be stupid enough to say that a giant bug that's going to eat him is nice? Well, he yawned. Sorry, Father, it's been a really long day. But the thing is, when I first got here and met the Empress, it was up on the outer wall of the palace, I tried to kill myself. You know, to show her I wasn't going to let her have her way with me. I jumped off the wall, 6 stories to the ground. Except that I didn't fall all the way. They have this invisible net, like a web to catch anyone who jumps. Well, I had an allergic reaction to it and almost died anyway. I was in a coma for nearly a solid week. Fath, the Empress held me the entire time. Wrapped her tentacles and a few legs around me and held me while I was medicated and while I slept. The whole week she held me. When I woke up, she told me that creatures like us respond as much to physical contact as to medicine. So she held me. I asked her why she didn't kill me when she had the chance. She said she doesn't want to kill me. She wants, he yawned again. Oh, sorry. She wants to keep me alive as long as she can. She wants me for company, to be her friend. That's why I say she's nice and that I trust her. I know you think that's crazy, that I'm being brainwashed, but even if I am, I have to live through this right to the end. So I have to trust someone, and the Empress is that someone. One interesting thing is that the Empress is Empress in title only. Her children run the empire. She is more of a slave than anything else. She lays eggs for 50 years at a stretch, then has to mate. She gets a break of a month or so, mates, and then goes back to laying eggs again. Father, she's lonely. And in a very real sense, we're stuck with each other. That's another reason I trust her, because we're both in the same boat. I can't leave, and neither can she. She didn't even have a choice in who her mate would be. The thing is, there's a team of genetic engineers who plan what sort of genetic traits, what genetic influences will be necessary for the next generation. They study the matter, home in on a particular species that has the traits they're looking for, then they study them and zero in on a specific individual. He gets acquired and delivered to the Empress, who has to mate with him. Lucky me, huh? Buggy's, she wants me to call her Buggy. How weird is that? Buggy's Fizz told her that I ought to be told about the mating so I'll know what to expect. They had an argument about it. Buggy wanted to put it off, but the Fizz insisted and stood there while she explained it to me. I'd like to roast that Fizz alive over a slow fire. Anyway, she's not going to eat me as such. I'll still die, which is all I cared about. But she says it will be mostly painless. She has these four things that come like straws that come out of her neck that she'll poke into my shoulders and belly. She'll inject an anesthetic that will knock me out, and then she'll suck the liquid out of me. Drink me dry. Romantic, huh? But there's one thing that isn't romantic. Buggy says that if she ever drinks from me without knowing she's doing it, it means that instinct is taking over and it's time to do it whether we want to or not. Want to? Well, I know what she means. What she gets, Exie yawned mightily, what she gets is the liquid, and the liquid is DNA. That mixes with her own DNA and gets made into her eggs. Then there's what happens when I'm dry. I figured I'd get tossed aside like an old rag, but Buggy says I won't. She has a catacomb under the palace where she puts the bodies of all her mates. She says it's a way of honoring them by enshrining their remains and reminding herself that they were living beings once. She actually visits them. And there's a crypt down there waiting for me. Ooh, I can hardly wait. I'm sorry, Father. I wanted this communique to be cheerful. I guess I can't get the morbid stuff out of my head. I sure hope you can. Let me tell you about Buggy. Space, what a name. When I suggested it, I was just joking, but she jumped on it and insisted I call her Buggy from then on. So I have. Apart from her staff bossing her around, they even control her diet. But she has a lively and interested personality. She can talk on almost any subject and is eager to learn anything new. When she gets happy, her eyes light up. I'm not sure how to describe it, but they get a kind of iridescent glow. She's got a formal garden, first planted 100,000 years ago. It's got flowers and shrubs from every planet in the empire. We had breakfast there this morning. Exie yawned again. A nice basic breakfast, toast, honey, about six different kinds, four or five kinds of fresh fruit, including some excellent Compay, perfectly ripe, full-flavored, and 8 months out of season. and tea. Then she took me on a tour of the palace. Lots of offices, audience halls, parlors, a few bedrooms, several suites, plus the nursery and the catacomb. And would you believe it? They've got an indoor pool, too. One of her mates had been a water dweller. I had a swim. Buggy's staff wouldn't let her put in any more than a foot or two. We had lunch and dinner in two separate dining rooms. More food from home, more or less. They have a kitchen somewhere with a chef who's like any other chef. Any good basic dish is never enough. They have to dress it up, make it more spectacular. After dinner, we went up on the walls and looked at the stars for a few hours. Buggy loves looking at the stars. She says it gives her a sense of freedom. I guess she's right. Then along came her fizz and ordered me to go to bed and scolded Buggy for keeping me up so late. We both laughed at her, but here I am in my private bedroom. Exie yawned again, hard. Father, I had to communicate with you before I turned in. Buggy says I can communicate as often as I want, so expect regular communics from me. Buggy says when they're delivered, the courier will stay close by in case you want to send a reply. So please do reply. I miss you like crazy. I love you, Fath. Never forget that. I'll communicate as often as I can. Kiss Albie for me. He paused for a minute, then stopped the recorder. Yawning prodigiously, he got up and walked to the door. Two guards stood out in the corridor. They both turned to look at him, and he handed the recorder to one of them. Send this to my father, fastest possible speed. The guard nodded, and Exie closed the door.
The end.
Well, that's the end of the communication to his father, but there's more to the story.
Oh, I see. Okay.
But that's the part that I chose to read. We have a little over 15 minutes. I can read more if you like.
Your call.
All right. We'll
By the way, back. Before we do that, I don't think I mentioned the author of this fine publication.
No, you did not.
And I will do that. And also tell you where you can pick up a copy. This is authored by Deborah Sala. I hope I pronounced your name correctly. And the book is available at the Berkshire Emporium. By the way, that store has a great many interesting books. So if you're into books or like to read local information, just go in and Keith can show you where they are, and there's plenty to be had. My commercial is over.
Very good. Well done. So
I didn't get
this
paid for
scene, I was going to skip over the pool, but something very interesting happens here. When Exie had swum 20 laps, he walked up out of the water and sat down, panting. The Empress handed him a towel. You swim well, she said. Thank you. I am also impressed by your dedication to staying fit. It would be so easy for you to become self-indulgent. Exie rubbed the towel over his chest and back. What can I say? I've always liked swimming, and I learned early to take exercise where and when I can. Besides, if I could get you in here, I wouldn't be exercising. Really? What would you be doing? Oh, I expect we'd be playing more than anything. Playing? Dropping the towel, Exie waded back in and drove the heel of his palm into the surface, sending a spray of water at the Empress. Having fun, he said. The Empress laughed. This is why I adore you. No one else has ever treated me like an equal before. No one else has ever dared to call me Buggy before. It is why I hold you more precious than any mate I have ever had before. Are you saying that you love me? The iridescence faded from the Empress's eyes. I am not certain. Love is an emotion outside of my experience. I am considering it. Exe shook his head. 1 million years, and that's the best you can come up with? He strode out of the water, went straight to the Empress, and pressed his lips against hers. After a minute, he withdrew and began toweling off again. The Empress stared at him blankly. Are you saying that you love me? Exe was silent for a minute, then shrugged. I'm sorry, Buggy. I just don't know yet. I'm considering it. The Empress paused a moment, then burst into laughter. Bridesmaid, but never a bride. Always a bride. The sky was crystal clear and the darkness surprisingly deep. The buildings nearest the palace were workplaces, and the streets went unlit, so stargazing was easy. Exe lounged against a parapet while the Empress raised a part of herself so she could look straight up. There, she said, pointing. Exe moved closer to her so he could follow her pointing tentacle. She appeared to be indicating a specific star. And that is, I believe Zinc World 358 orbits that star. It has the largest Ibdinium mine in the galaxy. And what's your interest in Ibdinium? Its value. It is the rarest known metal. Consequently, the most expensive. Do you own the mine? Dear, no. The zinc have virtually no use for it. The miners are from the Rigel system. Then why are you so interested in it? I was wondering how much of it I would need to have to have a monument made of it. Exe laughed. I'd guess even more than you can afford. Then again, it all depends on the size of the monument. What are you planning to memorialize? You? Exe gasped. Me? The Empress looked down at him. You? I am thinking of having a monument erected on your home world so everyone there will know how precious you are to me. Exe shook his head, disbelieving. Buggy, it's an honor, but believe me, I'd rather you didn't. Why ever not? Because monuments are invisible. Not literally, of course, but they become invisible. How? Well, when they're unveiled, there's a lot of fanfare and excitement, but after a while, people stop noticing them. They just become part of the background. People walk past them every day and don't even see them anymore. That is sad, the Empress exclaimed. Something must be done about that. I suppose so, but I have no idea what. Is it enough that I'm in a crypt in the catacomb? No one visits the catacomb but I. I want your people to know my feelings for you. Buggy, I'm honored, but I don't deserve a monument. I'm just an ordinary guy that got chosen to be your mate by sheer luck. Tempted to argue, the Empress asked, good luck or bad? I don't know. Both, I guess. The thing is, I don't see myself as someone who deserves a monument. Though if you really want one, you should build it here. Here? On the Zinc homeworld. You can make sure it doesn't become invisible by insisting that everybody visit it. Of course, if you do that, your people will pack you off to a mental hospital in half no time. We have no mental hospitals, Exe. My point is they'll think you're insane. Sometimes I think they think so anyway. Why? Because of the way I behave during courtship. You see, the Zinc are a very efficient race. When my daughters mate, they waste no time with courtship. They do the deed, the same as with any other task. They do it and get it done with. Considering what is expected of me, that I lay eggs, they wonder why I dally with you, why I spend hours and days conversing with you and share my thoughts with you. Why don't I just mate and get back to the nursery? They do not know boredom or loneliness. If it's any comfort, I do. Exie raised a hand and rested it on her carapace. The Empress looked startled and glanced down at him, then redirected her gaze upward at the endless sky. It does, Exie. It certainly does. And there's still more. There's the actual mating, which I'll skip over.
Good.
But I will read the final section, which I probably shouldn't do, but I'm going to anyway. Just to punish those of you who don't go to the website and read the story for yourself. So there. 30 years. 30 years of pumping out eggs day and night. 30 years and she still missed him. She'd only known him about a month, but it felt longer. If she were capable of weeping, she'd have shed an ocean of tears. But she wasn't, so her mourning was more intellectual. She thought about him endlessly, hoping he would have as strong an influence on their children as he'd had on her. She was tempted to demand that personality be a factor considered by the genetic engineers when they chose her future mates. She never wanted to fall in love with one again. But she knew the odds were against it. 1,050,000 years, and there had been only one. She was safe enough. Imperial Mother, a young queen, was bowing to her. Yes, child. The youngster swayed her tail section uncomfortably, which is a sign of distress. Imperial Mother, I come to you with an issue of a personal nature. Yes. Imperial child, I know who I am. Explain your issue to me. Yes, I beg your pardon. I was born to be an engineer, a structural engineer. I am studying the courses I need, mathematics, construction design, and theory, and so on. But as I study, I often find my mind wandering. At times, other ideas will come to me that lead me astray. At other times, what I am studying will make me think of something else, and that will lead me astray. Mother, I have never heard of a disease or condition like this before, and it frightens me.
Frightens you?
Mother, if I continue to be led astray, I shall be a failure as an engineer and a disappointment to you. I desire to excel. Child, you are incapable of disappointing me. The condition you describe is nothing more than your father's influence. The queen gasped.
My father?
In our species, males are useless, save in only one respect, mating. Unless we mate, our race and civilization will cease to exist. But in many other species, males are more important. They do not die in the act of mating, but live to help rear their young. They are considered equal partners with their females. These are the males with whom I, often enough, must mate. And though they die, they yet have an influence on their young. 35% of your DNA comes from your father. You should treasure that part of yourself, for he was a treasure in and of himself. A male? A treasure? The Empress laughed gently. You did not know him, child. If you did, perhaps you would understand him better. As to your issue, you must simply apply yourself. When you feel your mind wandering, force it back into concentrating on your studies and your work. But in the meantime, I have another task for you. The Empress expelled a light cloud of mist. Tiny, fragrant droplets settled on the young queen. Go to the Imperial Library. The pheromone you have just received will gain you access to both the library and the book you must read. There is a set of books of 100,000 volumes. These are the books about my mates. Look in the last volume.
It will tell you all about your father, how and why he was chosen, everything I can remember about him, his likes and dislikes and things we discussed, as well as his correspondence between him and his father. Read these accounts, child, and commit him to your memory. Yes, mother. Then go and gather your sisters, as many as you can, and instruct them to read the same accounts. Let your father be remembered by all the Zinc. The queen bowed. As you command, Imperial Mother. The Empress watched her walk away, iridescence lighting her eyes. Exie would have loved that one. Yes, and been proud of her, too. Imperial Mother. Another queen, burdened with a small potted plant, was bowing to her. The gardener. Yes, child. I believe we are making progress, Mother. She held out the pot, and the Empress took hold of it. It was a single flower, white petals flecked with dark blue. As she studied it, the bare elements of a face began looking out at her. Eyes, a nose, a mouth, a shock of hair. Impressive, she said, handing back the pot. Do you believe the features can be refined sufficiently? I do, Mother. How much longer will it be before it is perfected? That is difficult to say, Mother, but I would guess another 10 years. Excellent. When it is perfected, grow as many as you can. Choose any spot in the garden you think fit and plant a bed thick with them. Then prepare a large shipment for Exie's home world. Some are to go to his family, but I particularly want them planted all around the monument. The queen bowed. As you command, Imperial Mother. And that's the end of the story.
And now we return from the Twilight Zone.
Well, I don't consider it the Twilight Zone. I consider it a kind of romance. The thing about the flower is there's another scene where he tells her, well, you know, I'm not just another pretty face. And she says, you're the pretty face. If my gardeners could grow a flower with your face on it, I'd have an entire bed planted in the garden. And that's all we have time for. Nicole, thank you very much for directing.
Thank you, Nicole.
We love you. Thank you for being here. Thank me for being here. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you next week.
That is a little weird.